big specific and answer two questions that I was asked. The first question was, or we were asked, how to move beyond this deadlock? How to move beyond this deadlock? Our governments reach agreements, but then the agreements are not implemented. Fossil fuels are being used widely all over the world. We are still contributing to climate change. And there's disaster and catastrophic situations such as the weather in many islands, states, or coastal cities. So the question was how to move beyond this deadlock. And the question was asked to a specific network that deals with just as in mining or extractive industries. That's the Jesuit network that I'm representing here. So, no big answer or magic solutions. How to move beyond this deadlock? There's only two ways. One that comes from the doctrine, the social doctrine of the church, changing structures and changing. It's a double avenue to change. Changing structures and changing cultures. What are structures? Structures are laws, regulations, practices, you know, things that big powers, governments do, and also big companies. And cultures is what we do in our everyday life. So, from the mining perspective, we ask, okay, how able are we to change mining laws and regulations, mining practices and financing, which is very important as well when we talk about mining. And we came to the conclusion as a network, we cannot change everything all over the world, but sometimes we detect a political and advocacy opportunity to change something specific. And we can contribute to that as a network. So that was the example. There's two examples now that we have, or two political advocacy opportunities to change laws and regulations in terms of mining. One is the United Nations Treaty on Business and Human Rights. There is a proposal from the United Nations and civil society organizations as well, and some governments to agree on a binding treaty on business and human rights that is going to control a little bit better what big transnational corporations do elsewhere. It's a little bit, the treaty is complicated, but it wants to put an end to impunity. I mean, those transnational companies violating human rights in foreign countries could be judged and trialed in a home country. That's what the treaty wants. And it's a result of many years of reflection of many civil society organizations asking the question how to move beyond this deadlock. Some of us, we're saying, we need binding regulations, and we don't have a world authority, as Pope Francis says here, so maybe we can start to the judiciary to define the regulation. There's another avenue that we can use, and in fact, we are already using some Jesuit institution, which is divestment. Divestment, there's two Jesuit two Canadian conferences have divested from carbon investment, for coal mining, for example. They say, no more, our money does not go to fossil fuels anymore. Georgetown University did the same. They decided to divest. Divestment, as a treaty, is a complicated thing. It's not like, okay, I don't put my money here, but you have to decide where you're going to invest. How are you going to use your finances and your financial power to change some structures and some practices? So, in our network, just as in mining, we have right now, in terms of a global initiative and focusing initiatives, we have detected somehow. We think we can do something. We can contribute. to initiatives regarding United Biodiversity of Business and Human Rights in the specific field of mining, because this treaty talks about all kinds of activity, but with them we can contribute a little bit in that, and also the diversity. Culture. What can we do regarding from the bottom? Ourselves. Change our hearts. Change our minds about climate change, about lifestyles. You know, change, I would say as well, I would add, change our hands as well, and our mouths as well. They were saying, okay, we can change our lifestyle, we can eat less meat, waste less. We can ask for clean textiles or clean technology as well. So, and we're talking about, maybe this word is offensive, imperial lifestyles that we people in the north and some people in emerging countries, we have imperial lifestyles. We are consuming too many resources and contributing to this climate change and to this green scenario. So we are demanding, and that's why we have this fantastic umbrella theological document that I really encourage you to read, which is like the Laudato Si, that talks a lot about lifestyle and how we can change our hearts, minds, our mouths, and how we behave in order to contribute to this common realm where we all live. And also we have an umbrella organization as Justice Mining, which is Ecogest, which is the institution that has invited and united us all here today. How to collaborate with others? That was the second question. So I say, well, we are already collaborating. We are already collaborating with some of us, not all just with our organizations everywhere. We are collaborating between different conferences and your surroundings, for example. I collaborate with the Australians, with Latin Americans, with Africans for specific projects regarding mining industry. We have alliances with very powerful civil society organizations such as CITSI or URAC for this United Nations mining treaty. We need deep accompaniment. I mean, what Pedro was saying is true. You know, they're killing natural resource defenders everywhere, and particularly in Central America, particularly in Honduras. Those people need our deep accompaniment. It's not only a question of staying a little bit and then going away, deep accompaniment. And nurturing structures for our networks. Well, and one example of this collaboration is Conflict-Free Technology. It's a campaign run by, within this, the framework of Jesuit Networking, was started by European organizations, Alboa and Jesuit Missions at Desk in Brussels, and we decided that under the umbrella of Justice and Mining Global, we decided that, and the collaboration on Africa, and collaboration of Jesuit, and the collaboration of European citizens, we decided, okay, let's raise awareness about the links between our use of technology and the war faced in Congo. And we started like changing laws and raising awareness, and we have more information there. So, as a conclusion, I will use one metaphor. It's our common home, as Pope Francis says, this is our common home. Regarding extractive industries and mining, in particular, what we need, what we think, the church, ourselves, we have to be a refuge for those who are risking their lives, particularly indigenous organizations, indigenous populations, and human rights defenders, as Pedro was saying. That's the first priority. And we have an open door in this house, an open door to act in this United Nations by treaty. That's going to take a lot of effort, a lobbying effort, to really pass it up. So, and we will particularly, we can contribute in specific field of mining. One open window, that's divestment initiatives, decarbonization, and some of the initiatives that have already started, Georgetown, Canadian provinces, the Italian part province as well, divested from carbon investments. And one big garden, and those are the schools, the Jesuit schools, universities, social centers. We all share the same background. We have this fantastic document, this fantastic legacy, and we all want to plant a seed for a better world. So I would like to end that with three expressions that are within my legacy and I really like, which is live wisely,